very good evening to all of you watching Pava News. And in today's episode, we're discussing power sector reforms and the task ahead. To discuss the same, we've been joined by Mr. Ashok Lavasa, Additional Secretary, Ministry of Power, Mr. B.C. Jena, Chairman SESU, Mr. S.N. Verma, Chairman JSEB, Mr. N. Srivastava, MD UGVCL, Mr. Ramesh Narayanan, CEO BSES Yamuna, Mr. Reggie Kumar, President India Smart Grid Forum, and Professor Atmanan, Dean MDI Gurgaon. Very good evening and welcome to Power News. According to the Planning Commission estimate, electricity distribution losses are around 70,000 crore in 2010-11, and it has been projected that the losses will go up to ₹1,40,000 crore by 2012-15. Don't you feel the entire reform program has gone haywire?
Sustainability of the power sector is fully dependent on distribution. The real problem is the losses in the distribution system is quite high. It is as high as 70% on the LT side. If 1 MU of power is going on the LT side, 30% is being billed. It indicates that whatever meters were recording did not reflect in the bills. This is something which need to be addressed very urgently.
Well, what should be the way forward for DISCOMs to recover these losses and state regulators to create a favorable condition for sustainable growth of the sector?
In a lot of state, you have problems of, the meters not being recording well, but the Electricity Act clearly provides, look, you got to replace all these meters with static meters, electronic meters. Now the DISCOMs don't have money. They are not able to replace their outlived equipments. You have to provide necessary financial environment so that these money can flow to these DISCOMs. They are able to revamp their network. They are able to implement electronic meter. They are able to technologically defeat all those things which are going wrong so that the actual benefit of reform can percolate to the end user.
The problem in our country is that in the distribution system is still, I must compare it with the petrol and diesel, that is also sold by a government company. But once you pay, you get the petrol or diesel. First you have to pay in any petrol pump. But for the electricity, it is really shameful that still we feel that you can get it free. But the basic infrastructure in the distribution is that you must recover that money. If you don't recover, you cannot sustain. And the whole of the power system cannot sustain, even not the generation, even not the transmission. I tell you, for last 9 months I am there as Chairman Jharkhand, the State Electricity Board. I have increased the revenue from 147 crores realization per month to 200 crores. So where from that money came? No excess power input, no. So it means loss has mitigated. It was 41%, now we have come to 37%. So we are advertising it. We are reaching to the people that you cannot get it free. You will have to pay for it. That is very important in the distribution. And I believe the central government is supporting very well in this way.
See, from the government of India's side, some major schemes have been launched. One was APDRP, which was launched in the 10th plan. And then the restructured APDRP in the 11th plan. The thrust of both these programs is reduction of AT&C losses, but they are confined to the urban areas. The restructured APDRP, the way it has been designed, it has an outlay of something like 52,000 crores, and it is meant to cover 1,401 towns of this country. These 1,401 towns of the country, they account for something like 45% of energy which is consumed.
Well, the restructured APDRP kicked off with a lot of fanfare and optimism. 3 years down the line, some questions related to the programs have, however, remained unanswered. Has the program lived up to the hype and euphoria?
The program covers 1,401 towns and everything in one go. No other country or utility has embarked on such transformation project. Doing setting up an IT network and IT infrastructure, doing automation, GIS, getting the consumers and the assets mapped on a GIS map. It is nothing less than a smart grid project which is being done in Europe or in America. But we called it at that time as a APDRP program, came out with a SRS document, what the specification, what should be done. It's no doubt it was supposed to be done in 18 months. It's taking a little more time. Everybody knew 18 months it cannot be done. It may take 36 or 42 months. When completed, it's going to create an enabling environment where many of the problems can at least be visualized. Earlier, we didn't know. When the unbundling happened, all the problems on paper as well as on field came to the distribution sector. So where it is after this IPDRP systems or RIPDRP systems are implemented, we'll be able to visualize and then correct it. And this kind of transformation doesn't happen in 1 year or 5 year or 10 year. So it will take 15, 20 years. So all stakeholders have to work together to do that.
One thing that I would like to highlight is that when we go for smart grid and technology upgradation, what the DISCOM faces is network problem. Our network, DISCOM as such is being said that's the weakest link. So why it is the weakest link? It's because the network is 40 years old, 30 years old. Yeah. Our conductors are very old, our transformers Absolutely. Are very old, all electrical equipments are old. Now when we put the smart grid on such type of network, it will not work. The network has to be now revamped and done separate and done differently. That's why there is in the smart grid program, there is part A and part B. Now in the part B, when we go for part B implementation, we find the problem of huge capital requirement. Expecting the DISCOM to take the money at the market rate and pay all the and do all those smart grid and upgradation of technology, and that too on a very wide scale, it becomes slightly painful. So important thing is how to put the capital investment, which is a must, in order to improve our reduce our losses, and at a reasonable rate. Here the support from the government of India, without that it's just impossible, I think.
Time to take a short break here. You keep watching Power News.
To turn movements into a ballet, you need a choreographer. To turn products into integrated solutions, you need Larsen & Toubro. L&T's engineering expertise, manufacturing capability, and application experience by introducing new levels of pace, performance, and convenience at major utilities around the country. Integrated solutions in electrical and automation from Larsen & Toubro.
आज फिर मशीन बंद हो गई।
मशीन तो ठीक है, बिजली धोखा दे गई, केबल ही घटिया है।
मानो या न मानो, आज भी कई औद्योगिक क्षेत्रों में बिजली की कमी के कारण हजारों लोगों को खाली हाथ घर लौटना पड़ता है। तो क्यों ना एक ऐसा पावर केबल चुने जो बिजली बचाए, बिजली का घाटा रोके और शॉर्ट सर्किट का जोखिम घटाए।
चुने रवीन केबल्स।
प्राइम कैब, रवीन केबल्स उत्पादन।
Welcome back. You're watching Power News. Well, those distribution utilities which are state-owned and under specific instruction from the government, they tend to avoid filing the tariff petition in time or in proper form before the state power regulators. Recently, many states have done the tariff revision almost after 5 to 6 years.
When you know that power generation is costlier, you will have to face it that the tariff has to be higher if you want to viable make the industry viable. Unfortunately, state has its own role of popularity and unpopular decision, you know. And many of the state, I don't want to quote, that you will find that within 10 years, no tariff enhancement is there. What it says very clearly that government will run it with subsidies. And now the today scenario you see very well in the country, that it is even unbundling, the things have not been sustained because they started with zero again, with all their losses vanished. But again, it is not being sustained in many of these states. So you will have to see in the sectionalized way, once the tariff must come to a level of the market rate, so that the tariff, if you are recovering from the people or from the industry, it should be viable. Still in Jharkhand, the agriculture tariff is 55 paise only. I purchased that power at 4 rupees, but I'll have to supply as per the government direction. So then there should be a cross subsidy from the government, which we call resource gap, and it is not always there in time. So the losses are there, the overdraft problem is there in the banks.
Do you feel the politicians have a fear to pass on the actual cost of power to the consumer, and that is why the tariff is not revised in a time-bound manner?
The distribution companies are mere retailers. They buy power and then they distribute. The distribution cost, even for the worst performing utility in the country, has not gone up materially high. It is the power purchase component, you know, which has gone up phenomenally high. If the petrol prices or any of the fuel prices goes up, you don't go and haul up the petrol pumps. You know, they are just vending agencies. The same way the distribution companies are not responsible if the components are going up. So what do you need? You need a simple formula. You need a simple formula where you have to factor in the power purchase cost, you have to factor in the financing cost, and then you have to give a normative level for the distribution cost. And so far, these things are transparent. Every single citizen is going to approve of it.
Even some state regulatory commissions have not been performing their duties well. Power Ministry is now planning to set up a government-appointed panels to carry out performance appraisals of regulators at both the centre and state level. Don't you think there is an urgent need to bring regulatory reform in the sector?
In fact, I would say that the APTEL has gone one step ahead. And what they have said is that they would expect each and every regulator, state regulator, to file a compliance report by June with the Forum of Regulators, and the Forum of Regulators is expected to then apprise the APTEL about the state of compliance of their order. So I think if all the state regulatory commissions were to abide by the elements contained in that order, which has also been supplemented incidentally by the Forum of Regulators bringing out a model tariff regulation. The model tariff regulation has been adopted by the forum, and the forum consists of all the state regulators. And now each of the regulator is expected to issue a regulation out of that model tariff regulation. And together, they lay out the framework which will govern the determination of tariff. And many of the things which are being mentioned here, and many of the things which are responsible for inadequacy of tariff, will get addressed.
Yes.
If this model tariff regulation is followed in spirit and APTEL's orders are complied with. So I think that should make tariffs look a lot more rational than what they do today.
The most of the regulatory commission faces in the states that what they want to revise, the tariff of the state electricity board, and where the account has not been audited for 6-7 years. This is the problem of the most of the state electricity boards. And the regulations are so tough that one or two regulatory commission has so much to increase the tariff. Otherwise, you will have to have an audited account. You see, in Jharkhand for 7 years, it was not audited. Well, now only the 10-11 is left. We got it completed within that 8 months of my tenure. But it was important. The tariff of Jharkhand is the lowest in country. It is the same power which is in Gujarat. It is the same power which is in Maharashtra. It is the same power which is purchased by Bihar and the Jharkhand on the same tariff rate from NTPC. But we are getting less because of the tariff which has been given by the regulatory commission. But they say you don't have the audited accounts. They say that the loss is 41%. So I will deduct. We will say that it is the penalty on the electricity board that will not reflect it in the AR. So what basically we get? We get a lower tariff. So that part is also to be the seen by the government or the CERC, that how the regulations of the regulators are made, that it make the sustainable the department.
The SEBs had a very different system of accounting which was not understood by the commercial world. So when the unbundling took place, one of the expectations was that all these utilities will run under the Companies Act and abide by all the requirements of the Companies Act. Now, although Today we still feel that there are many companies which are not up to date in their accounts, but I think as we talk today, more than 50% of the distribution utilities have their accounts, audited accounts, ready for year 9-10. And there is no reason why. I mean, who prevents a distribution company from getting its accounts audited? Do they require technology? Do they require central assistance? No.
No. We have every single year from 2002 onwards fully audited and done by not just the statutory auditors. We have an internal audit system. It meets the best of standards both nationally and internationally. Coming to that issue with respect to regulators, you know, it's very important that you see when the regulatory mechanism is very vital for the sector. He decides the fate of the sector thoroughly. So it's very important that you should have people knowledgeable from the sector. Or even if they are not there, you got to have some kind of an orientation and updation programs. Unfortunately, the regulators are appointed for 5 years. By the time they pick up the ropes of this trade, it's too late. It's too late. The sector is suffering for that. So it's very important that you should have modules for the regulators to be trained on this before they decide the fate of the entire sector.
See, the very clear perspective which were given in the Electricity Act 2003 and by setting up the Regulatory Commission 1998, what is the role of the regulator? It is very much clearly defined there. What is the role of the state government? What is the role of the state electricity board? Now, the objective of the state government would be to provide a policy directions to accelerate the power sector reforms at the state level. It is defined in the Act that the role of the regulator by setting up the SERC at different states would be to, number one, to determine the tariff on the basis of the cost. Number two, to ask the distribution company to submit their petitions regularly, quarterly, to evaluate them, to audit them. And three, to allow them as to how the unbundling can be further strengthened. Now, we have come to know from various reports from the media and the newspaper that barring few states, 10 to 12 states, majority of the states out of the 29 which have really been able to set up the SERC have not even filed petitions to the SERCs. So therefore, regulators are today being regulated by the state government, and therein, in fact, if the state government is interfering into that, look, this should be the tariff rate and this should not be the tariff rate. Look, this should be the balance sheet position, that this is what you are supposed to mention and you are not supposed to show the book losses to the tune of this much, then I think India won't be far ahead of in power sector reforms if there is too much of political interference in the autonomy of the functioning of the regulators.
APTEL read out and explained and interpreted the provisions which are existing in the Act, which gives suo moto powers to the regulatory commission, that in the absence of an ARR which is filed, he still has the power to determine the tariff.
Absolutely.
He has the power to direct
them
to do certain act. So I think as far as the Act is concerned, as far as the provisions in the law are concerned, we probably don't suffer from the inadequacy of provisions.
Well, we'll continue this discussion, but after this short break.
When you are determined to be a winner, your desire to conquer is fueled by the power of your instinct. With eyes set on the target, you create your own path. Your determination inspires you to never give in. Then emerges a creator of a winning journey, blazing a trail for others to follow. We are Jindal Power Limited. Northeastern Electric Power Corporation Limited, a Schedule A corporation under the Ministry of Power. playing a significant role in the integration and efficient development of hydroelectric and thermal power projects in the central sector, benefiting life, benefiting people. NEEPCO, contributing and empowering the life of Northeast region.
Welcome back, you're watching Power News, and in today's episode we're discussing power sector reforms and the task ahead. The CERC has proposed very strict penalties on DISCOMs for overdrawal. Don't you think the imposition of additional UI charges for DISCOMs would hurt them financially and lead to further load shedding?
I personally noticed that in certain part of the year, in the last year, from November to January, the frequency was very less, and still probably some of the distribution companies kept on using the same quantum of power. So in days to come, the utilities have also to be train themselves how to operate within those UI and reduce their demands. Otherwise, it is very much possible that even though the actual power purchase is at a lesser cost, but because of the UI charges and because the utility didn't take decision at the right time, the cost of power has gone up.
An area where technology should be leveraged. Peak load management, the marginal cost of procurement is higher during the peak hours. So peak load management, leveraging technology, demand response, which is being considered now when the APDRP programs are, when it will be relaunched for the 12th plan, consumers with some higher level of load and above mandatory demand response programs will to be implemented. It has to be technology enabled, remotely controlled by the utilities control center. When there is a 50 megawatt shortage, Mr. Narayan should be able to switch off some people's air conditioner or some big power guzzling equipment in the industries remotely, instead of buying 50 megawatt at 10 rupees and supplying at 4.5 rupees. This is exactly where the smart grid comes into place.
The moment I pay for the power I am drawing, it triggers demand side management.
Correct.
Now, because you see, I am paying 100 rupees, utilizing a worth of 1,000 rupees of power. So there is no sense. The moment I find that I am to pay 1,000 rupees, this will trigger demand side management.
Correct.
And demand side management, for your information, can save us around 15% to 20%. Conservation of energy, it has been proved in Delhi, 30% of power will be saved.
Mr. Lavasa, distribution franchisees can be seen as the way forward. We can take the example of Bhiwandi franchisee, which was able to show reduction in AT&C losses, reduce the transformer failure rates, and most importantly, enhance customer satisfaction. Do you think franchisee system is the best model for private participation in power distribution segment?
In a country as vast as India, and in circumstances as different as many of the distribution companies operate in, I don't think there is a need to be prescriptive from the Government of India's side that this is the only model which will work. There are examples of success in different models. What the Ministry of Power has done is that a standard bidding document for franchisees has been finalized, and it will be disseminated to the states that should they wish to go the franchisee route, they can follow this standard bidding document. And wherever they require changes, they can seek the approval of the regulator.
What the model has been prepared by the Government of India, even by Planning Commission, this is a guiding document.
Yes.
Basically, it will go to the state. We have got the distribution franchisee model also from the ministry. It is a guiding document. You prepare your own. You see to it that how it will facilitate you, how it will benefit you. And the Jharkhand is going for the distribution franchisee very soon. We are in the readiness of the document now. And we feel that private sector participation is with much of enthusiasm. They are coming to us, they want to go for it. And that shows very clearly that even in one town, 300, 400 crores will be invested for Ranchi, for Dhanbad, for Jamshedpur. They are ready to invest for 300, 400 crores to strengthen that distribution system. And they will reap the benefit when they reduce the losses.
You will be surprised to know that in one division having a consumer strength of 1,20,000, where the billing was about around 30-40%, after these groups were mobilized, it has gone up to 80%. And the realization in 1 year has been phenomenal, almost more than double what it was doing. regarding the PPP, we have devised another model that yes, we need this smart metering. We have said that let a private player who is a meter manufacturer basically install the meters, manage it for 5 years, take the meter reading, serve the bill. Whatever is the additional revenue, we share 50-50.
The total capital required for the power sector has been estimated to be about 10 lakh crores. So with this kind of a capital requirement, it makes all the more important that if you can tap more and more private engagement, either on an exclusive basis or through a franchisee model or through the PPP model or any innovative model which my co-panelist just mentioned, the one they are experimenting in Odisha, should be a welcome.
Well, power distribution utilities fear financial disaster as a recent government directive allowing industrial consumers to buy electricity directly from generators and traders. What are your views?
Assuming that the DISCOMs are not performing well and there is an open access now developing, there is a possibility that a consumer opts for open access and goes away from your collection area. So you incur a loss because the consumer has gone away from your fold. So the DISCOMs in future would have this problems from the open access as well.
That the Act provides that 1 megawatt and above consumers shall no longer be given electricity on regulated tariff. Now that does not mean that the distribution company cannot supply electricity to him. What is envisaged is as follows, that the 1 megawatt and above consumers, they are big consumers and they have the capacity to secure electricity from the market on market determined terms, not the terms set by the regulator. What the regulator will do, he will fix the charges of wheeling because you are using the network of the public utility, and he will fix a cross subsidization surcharge. These two or three charges which are to be paid by an open access consumer are upfront declared, they don't change day by day.
Clear that the open access will definitely provide or create a competitive enabling environment in the business of the electricity in our country. And the 1 megawatt open access is, I think, is a great success in these directions. Number one. Number two, in the years to come, the state electricity boards in our country will have to gear up themselves to face competitions from their own bulk consumers when they will start shifting from SEBs and buy electricity from the India Energy Exchange or Power Exchange or any local generator and producer electricity. It's not the question of cross subsidy, it is not the question of cross surcharge. It is the question of that, am I getting a reliable power, affordable power, regular power, a consumer asks. And if there is a agency which is available to give us a power, even 1 rupee or 50 paisa less from the market, consumers will go there.
Well, with this, we come to an end of this discussion. I'd like to thank all the panelists and delegates present here for joining us in Power News.